The Lord be with you.
With us.
Let's pray. O eternal God, our heavenly Father, who has given to us thy children an abiding citizenship in heaven, and in days of our pilgrimage, a citizenship also upon earth, give us thine aid as we journey to thy heavenly city, so faithfully to perform the duties which befall us on our way, that at the last we may be found worthy to enter unto thy rest. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty Lord and everlasting God, vouchsafe we beseech thee to direct
sanctify and govern both our hearts and bodies in the ways of thy laws and in the works of thy commandments, that through thy most mighty protection, both here and ever, we may be preserved in body and soul through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. Epistle and Gospel for the 23rd Sunday after Trinity are found on page 222 of the Book of Common Prayer. O God, our refuge and strength, who art the author of all godliness, be ready, we beseech thee, to hear the devout prayers of thy church, and grant that those things which we ask faithfully we may attain effectually, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
So may be seated.
In the 38th verse of the 27th chapter of the Apocryphal Book of Ecclesiastes. Malice and wrath, even these are abominations, and the sinful man shall have them all. He that revenged shall find vengeance from the Lord, and he will surely keep his sin in remembrance. Forgive thy neighbor the hurt he hath done unto thee, so thy soul shall thy sin also be forgiven when thou prayest. One man that beareth hatred against his neighbor, and for this seek pardon from the Lord, he showeth no mercy to a man which is like himself, and does he ask forgiveness of his own sin? For he that is but flesh, for he that is but flesh, nourish hatred, who will he entreat him of his sin? Remember thy end, and let enmity cease. Remember corruption and death, and abide in commandment. Remember the commandment, and bear no malice to thy neighbor. Remember the covenant of the highest, and wink at ignorance. Here ended the Old Testament.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle is taken from the epistle of Paul to the Philippians, chapter 3, beginning at the 17th verse. Brethren, you follow us together of me, and mark them which walk as ye have us for an example. For many walk, of whom I have told you often, now tell you even weeping, that they are the enemy of the cross of Christ, whose sin is destruction, whose God is their belly, whose glory is in their shame, and whose mind earthly things. For our citizenship is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change the body of our humiliation, that he may be confounded unto the body of his glory, according to the working whereby he is able even to subject all things unto himself. We are ending the epistle.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
22nd chapter, beginning at the 15th verse.
Glory be to the Lord.
Then went the Pharisees and took counsel how they might entangle him in his talk. And they sent out unto him their disciples with the Herodians, saying, Master, we know thou art true, and teach us the way of God in truth. Neither carest thou for any man, for thou regardest not the person of men. Tell us therefore, what thinkest thou? Is it lawful to give tribute unto Caesar or not? But Jesus perceived their wickedness and said, Why tempt ye me, ye hypocrites? Show me the tribute money. And they brought unto him a penny. And he said unto them, Whose is this image and superscription? They say unto him, Caesar's. Then saith he unto them, Render therefore unto Caesar the things which are Caesar's, and unto God the things which are God's. When they had heard these words, they marveled and left him and went their way. This is the gospel of the Lord. Meeting this afternoon at 12:30.
service. The Wednesday Bible study via Zoom at 7:30. If you're not on that call and would like to be, please add your name to the list on the easel, the notice board in Peel Hall. The EMC campaign continues. Bruce, can you give us a, I guess this is our second update. Sure. For your campaign. We're at least we're well into it now.
Right. We so far have 13 pledges back in the Every Member Covenant. And we have a lot of good news. We have a lot of people who want to invite their friends and neighbors to church. Really happy about that. And of course, this is all about time, treasure, and talent. So in the pledge card, we'd ask you if you haven't completed one, and many of you have, we understand that the pandemic has gotten in the way of a lot of things. So we encourage you to complete one. But on the pledge card, it has spaces for your time, treasure, and talent. In terms of treasure, of the 13 pledges, the total pledge so far is $77,060 for the 13 pledges. So we still have about twice that many pledges that we expect to get in before the campaign comes to a halt. So we're a little behind schedule this year, understandably so, but the budget committee is going to meet. And you know, this church is positioned in such a good way. Great location here on the freeway, right by major subdivisions that are growing. And our type of worship, traditional worship, is really in short supply in this area in so many ways. So we're excited. We're going to build a new education building. We have the money for that. We want to get that done next year. And God willing, it will be. But we still have to pay the light bills. So the pledges help us to plan for that. So we'd appreciate anyone that's not done their Every Member Covenant card. We have some at the back if you're here. Are there some that Father Jones was kind enough to send out in a PDF or something like that where you can print it out? Or contact me, Bruce Woodcock, and I will mail you one. Anyway, it's all good, but let's keep up the good work. The sun is out, so praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord for the sun shining.
Oh, one last thing. Everyone here, our baptizees, we have a little cake for Chase and Stephanie Bodie. But everyone can have a piece of cake. Unfortunately, it's not the whipped cream, it's buttercream, which I don't like that icing, but if you like buttercream, you're going to be happy. So.
Yeah. Well, we'll remember that the next time we make the cake. Finally, after the other announcements, I want to express the parish's deep appreciation for a longtime community, Ben Best, who is done supply with us so many times to cover vacations and illnesses for our Great Gregorius. We're blessed to have several wonderful musicians in the parish, and Ben is helping cover during this interim. Our former organist accepted a call at another church, and we in turn have called a new organist, but she will not be arriving until Christmas Eve. So, Ben, thank you so much for your ministry of music. The hymn before the baptism, and we will be processing down to the font, and the candidates for baptism will be joining us, is in the insert to your bulletin, very suitable for baptism. Come thou fount of every blessing. Thank you.
273 of the Book of Common Prayer, page 273. Have these persons been already baptized or no?
No.
Dearly beloved, for as much as our Savior Christ said, none can enter into the kingdom of God except he be regenerate and born anew of water and of the Holy Ghost, I beseech you to call upon God the Father, through our Lord Jesus Christ, and of his bounteous mercy, he will grant to these persons that which by nature they cannot have, that they may be baptized with water and the Holy Ghost, and received into Christ's holy church and made living members of the same. Let us pray. Almighty and immortal God, the aid of all who need, the helper of all who flee to thee for succor, the life of those who believe, and the resurrection of the dead, we call upon thee for these thy servants, that they, coming to thy holy baptism, may receive remission of sin by spiritual regeneration. Receive them, O Lord, as thou hast promised by thy well-beloved Son, saying, ask, and ye shall have, seek, and ye shall find, knock, and it shall be opened unto you. So give now unto us who ask, let us who seek find, open the gate unto us who knock, that these thy servants may enjoy thy everlasting benediction of thy heavenly washing, and may come to the eternal kingdom which thou hast promised by Christ our Lord. Amen.
Hear the words of the gospel written by St. John in the third chapter, the first verse. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, the ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God, for no man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him. Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus said unto him, How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I say unto thee, ye must be born again. The wind bloweth where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but canst tell whence it cometh, and whither it goeth. So is every one that is born of the Spirit.
Service continues on the top of page 276. And now being persuaded of the goodwill of our Heavenly Father towards these persons, declared by his Son, Jesus Christ, let us faithfully and devoutly give thanks unto him and say, praying together,
Almighty and everlasting God, Heavenly Father, we give thee humble thanks that thou hast vouchsafed to call us to the knowledge of thy grace and faith in thee. Increase this knowledge and confirms his faith in us evermore. Give thy Holy Spirit to these thy servants, that they may be born again and may inherit the blessings of salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the same Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
The service continues at the bottom of page 277, which is the form of the service for adults. Well, beloved, you have come hither desiring to receive holy baptism. We have prayed that our Lord Jesus Christ would vouchsafe to receive, to release you from sin, to sanctify you with the Holy Ghost, to give you the kingdom of heaven and everlasting life. Dost thou renounce the devil and all of his works, the vain pomp and glory of the world, with all covetous desires of the same and the sinful desires of the flesh, so that thou wilt not follow nor be led by them? Adventure.
I renounce them all, and by God's help will endeavor not to follow nor be led by them.
Dost thou believe in Jesus the Christ, the Son of the living God?
I do.
Dost thou accept him and desire to follow him as thy Savior and Lord?
I do.
so I believe all the articles of the Christian faith is contained in the Apostles' Creed.
I do.
Wilt thou be baptized in this faith?
That is my desire.
Wilt thou then obediently strive to keep God's holy will and commandments and walking in the same all the days of thy life?
I will, by God's help.
O merciful God, grant that like as Christ died and rose again, so these thy servants may die to sin and rise to newness of life.
Amen.
Amen.
Grant that all sinful affections may die in them, and that all things belonging to the Spirit may live and grow in them.
Amen.
Grant that they may have power and strength to have victory and triumph against the devil, the world, and the flesh.
Amen.
Grant that whosoever is here dedicated to thee by our office and ministry may also be endued with heavenly virtues and everlastingly rewarded through thy mercy, O blessed Lord God, who dost live and govern all things, world without end.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto our Lord God.
It is meet and right, so true.
It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should give thanks unto the Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Everlasting God. For that thy dearly beloved Son, Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of our sins, did shed out of his most precious side both water and blood, and gave commandment to his disciples that they should go and teach all nations, and baptize them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Regard, we beseech thee, the supplications of thy congregation. Sanctify this water to the mystical washing away of sin. And grant that these thy servants, now to be baptized therein, may receive the fullness of thy grace, and ever remain in the number of thy faithful children, through the same Jesus Christ our Lord, who live with thee, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, in whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, grant you to be strengthened with might by his Spirit and the inner man, that Christ dwells in your hearts by faith, you may be filled with all the fullness of God.
Amen.
We receive you into the congregation of Christ's flock, and we sign you with the sign of the cross, in token that hereafter you should never be ashamed to confess the faith of Christ crucified, and manfully to fight under his banner against sin, the world, flesh, and the devil, and continue God's faithful soldier and servants until your lives end. Seeing now, dearly beloved, that these persons are regenerate and have been grafted into the body of Christ's church, let us give thanks unto Almighty God for these benefits, and with one accord make our prayers unto him, that they may live the rest of their life according to this beginning. Sing together, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And for the time of prayer.
Thank you.
For using your worship and your devotion studies. These will be hearty things, most merciful Father, that is pleased thee to regenerate these thy servants with thy Holy Spirit, and receive them for thine own children, and to incorporate them into thy holy church, and we humbly beseech thee to grant that they, being dead to sin, may live under righteousness, and being buried with Christ in his death, may be partakers of his resurrection, so that finally, with the residue of thy holy church, they may be inheritors of an everlasting kingdom, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
The Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen. Congratulations, Christians. We welcome you into the fellowship of Christ Church and into this congregation. Our sermon hymn is number 344.
Thank you.
happened to listen to my sermon on rendering Caesar that was preached at the early service, because it is the sermon that's usually preached during the time of the Every Member Covenant campaign. So it will be distributed next week in print instead. So instead of one time a year when we really emphasize giving, we get to celebrate baptism. So that's probably something you'll enjoy more. You do not know that as many of us were baptized into Christ, were baptized into his death. Therefore, we were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we should walk in newness of life. Romans 6. This morning we welcome Chase and Stephanie into our church family, but more importantly into the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. Unlike many of us, they were not brought into the church as infants or small children. They have come to Christ as adults, and this is something that we are seeing more and more in our culture, because we have passed through a time in which so many have fallen away from the church. We're only a generation away from the church being out of business if it doesn't continue to perpetuate through having children and dedicating to the Lord, and through people being brought to the church because of the gospel. And so we celebrate today. As we move further into this post-Christian culture, there are fewer and fewer children. They're raised and practiced in Christian homes. But so many times it is as young adults that they begin to come to the church. It's interesting that in all Paul's letters, whenever he mentions baptism, he assumes that it's something that every one of his readers have experienced. In 1 Corinthians, when Paul talks about our oneness in Christ, he says, "For by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body." He was writing, of course, to the church in Corinth. Our relationship to Christ, therefore, must involve the connection to other Christians. In Galatians, when Paul talks about how our lives are shaped by our faith in Christ, he says, Galatians 3:27, "For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ." That's an interesting metaphor, that we have put him on. He is with us, in us. He is our guide, our model, our Savior, our indwelling conscience. Apart from Jesus, according to Paul, we are people without hope. And Mark 16, Mark writes, "He who believes and is baptized shall be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned." In Acts 2:38, St. Peter says, "Repent, and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gifts of the Holy Spirit." The sevenfold gifts of the Spirit that are reflected in the stained glass window that is over the front door of our church. A window that is not viewed from within, but only from without. Because we only come to the church because the Holy Spirit brings us here. Just as the doors of Anglican churches and some others are traditionally painted blood red. It's a reminder and a link to the Passover that we appear only through the blood of Christ. So at the very front door of the church, we have two important doctrines affirmed. As we consider how important these things are and how important baptism is, I want to share some of the images that are applied to baptism, and then single out one in particular to talk about. Baptism is seen in several ways, but always as a sacrament, it involves involves an outward invisible sign, which in this case is water, and making the sign of the cross, and the inward and spiritual grace, which are receiving the gifts of the Spirit, being made regenerate, forgiven of sins. Per the word of Holy Scripture, baptism is generally referred to in four ways. The first is as a covenant sign and seal. The second, in language of burial and resurrection, which we've heard. Third, as a ritual cleansing of sin. And fourth, in the language of a marriage. As a covenant sign, Paul tells us that baptism replaces ritual circumcision as our sign of covenant with God. Instead of the physical sign in the flesh of the Old Testament, Paul says that in Christ we have circumcision of the heart. Baptism is also about death and resurrection, which we've all heard. We share in his death, that is, symbolically, we are, if you think about when baptism is by immersion, which is not the only way baptism has been done through the ages, there is a symbolism of being buried in the water and then rising, buried in the grave and rising in life. The image is conveyed by the act of baptism, not the mode. Another image, and one that I'd like to cover this morning, is that of a wedding ceremony, which formalizes a lifetime commitment between a man and a woman. I realize that relating baptism to a wedding ceremony in our 21st century culture is not a picture that comes directly from Scripture, but by implication, a number of these things relate, particularly if we understand the Jewish wedding customs of the time of Christ. Jesus himself claimed the church as his bride. Paul said to the Romans, "Therefore, my brethren, you become dead to the law through the body of Christ, that you may be married to another, even to him who has raised you from the dead," in Romans 7:4. As Christians, we are individually and collectively the bride of Christ. This image of the wedding is one that some of the church fathers picked up. If we are collectively the bride of Christ, it makes sense that there's a particular point in time when our lives are joined with him and when we have entered into covenant with him. In fact, the word covenant itself is significant. Let me digress just a bit about the concept of covenant in the Bible. Think back to Abraham. God made a covenant with Abraham, promising that through his offspring, all the nations of earth would be blessed. And as a sign of that covenant, God commanded that all newborn male children be circumcised. And that ritual was to be a symbol of their faith in God, and it was an essential requirement of that covenant. If they were not circumcised, the Scripture says they were cut off from God's people. Then, several hundred years later, the law of Moses became the basis for a temporary covenant. When the law of Moses was first given, the Israelites pronounced their own vows of faithfulness with God. Just as in a wedding ceremony, the bride and groom promise with vows to be faithful and keep themselves only for each other. In Exodus 24:3, and all the people answered with one voice and said, All the words which the Lord said, we will do. We made a promise, a vow, to be faithful to our God. And God's promise in return was that he would be their God and he would love them and take care of them. Through this covenant relationship with Israel, God continually refers to Israel as his bride, whom he lovingly chosen from among other people, even when she was unfaithful to him. God was a loving husband who set his affections and promised to be singularly faithful. For ye are holy people to the Lord your God. Deuteronomy 7. The Lord your God has chosen you to be a people for himself, a special treasure above all the peoples of the face of the earth. Therefore know that the Lord your God, he is God. He is the faithful God who keeps his covenant and is merciful for a thousand generations of those who love him and keep his commandments. That covenant relationship lasted until the coming of the Messiah. which it all pointed, Jesus Christ. And with him came the new, the renewed covenant, the final covenant. And this covenant is no longer sealed with circumcision, but with baptism. But it implies the same relationship. In Christ, you have a different kind of circumcision, writes Paul in Galatians 2. A circumcision not done by human hands. It is through his death that you were made free from the power of sin. When you were baptized, you were buried with Christ, and you were raised up with him through your faith in God's power that was shown when he raised Christ from the dead. See, all of these play together. Paul says here that circumcision is not the seal of the covenant, it's now baptism. And if we are the bride of Christ, which we are, and if that marriage covenant begins with the act of baptism, which it does, then I think we can properly refer to baptism in that light among the others as something of saying it's a believer's wedding ceremony. Personally, I think it's a beautiful picture, and I think it's one that will help us appreciate the singular significance of being baptized in Christ in the name of the Trinity. Even more than that, to appreciate the significance of the relationship that opens up with God through his Son, Jesus Christ. So let's suggest just a couple more examples of this premise. Baptism is that point at which we become one with Christ. When we look at the marriage relationship, we see that in the beginning God created man and woman and joined them together in the union of the flesh and spirit, that we know as marriage, a unique relationship. Adam said, this is now bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Therefore, man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. When Jesus was talking about the permanence of the marriage relationship, he quoted that very passage and then added those words that are often quoted at a wedding. The two shall become one flesh. They're no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let not man put asunder. In marriage, the husband and wife form a permanent union. Two persons joined together as one. One body, one spirit, one purpose. Glorifying God through this relationship. In much the same way, Christ takes the church as his own bride. So that once united, the church becomes his body, and collectively we are the body of Christ. We, with our various gifts and talents, bring what God has given us, and we come together and become one body. We become one with him. And the beauty of this is perhaps best seen in Ephesians 5. It's a passage that talks about how husbands ought to treat their wives. But just when you think that that's the thrust of the passage, Paul turns it into a profound reference to the relationship of Christ and his church, which is us. So husbands ought to love their own wives as their own bodies, he writes. He who loves his wife loves himself, for no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes it and cherishes it, just as the Lord does the church. For we are members of his body and his flesh and his bones. See, the language is the same as what I was reading to you a minute ago. And then Paul says, for this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become as one flesh. This is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. Paul says that just as a man and a woman are joined together in one flesh as husband and wife, so also we are joined together in one flesh with Christ as his church. So when exactly does this change in relationship take place? It takes place at our spiritual wedding ceremony when we are baptized in the body of Christ. 1 Corinthians 12, St. Paul says, for by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jew or Greek, slave or free, and have all been made to drink into one Spirit. Paul tells us that our union into one body with Christ takes place when we are baptized. And baptism, just as in a wedding, there is a uniting. We become one body with Christ. I think that it is a particularly beautiful metaphor today, talking about Stephanie and Chase, who are together as husband and wife, and who are married to Christ. So the actual relationship is beautifully reflected in the greater relationship with Christ. The second point of the wedding metaphor is the purity of the bride. We talked about this in Bible study about a week ago. By Jewish custom, a bride in the first century would bathe herself in an act of ceremonial cleansing in a pool of living water called a mikveh. Jews still do this today. There are several other key events in life when they do so. But she would do so immediately before putting on her wedding dress. It's similar to our tradition today in that a bride wears a white wedding gown, which is intended to signify the purity of life that she brings to the bridegroom. But Christ is very much aware of the fact that we are, as fallen human beings, not coming to Him pure. None of us are without sin. Certainly none of us was without sin even when we're born. The time is newborn, it still inherits original sin. The beauty of baptism is that Christ is the one who cleanses us and makes us pure as He brings us into a loving relationship with Himself and the church. To describe that cleansing, Paul refers again to baptism. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church and gave Himself for it, that He might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that He might present it to Himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. You see, if you understand the Jewish wedding custom of the ceremonial bath, then this makes more sense to you as you read it. It's one of the reasons we actually study the Bible. Through baptism, we've been washed. We've been washed clean in the blood of Christ, which is an interesting metaphor, and in the process, we become spotless to Him. In Acts 22, Paul reflects on his own personal experience when he says that Ananias had told him, "And now, why are you waiting? Arise and be baptized, and wash away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord." That's when Paul had been made to see after being blinded. And it's the same for each of us. With the waters of baptism, the bridegroom Jesus Christ washes away our sins, and through His work makes us acceptable to God. We put on Christ, we put on His purity. And then third and finally, the exchange of wedding vows. Without a question, the most important part of any wedding ceremony is the exchange of vows between the bride and the groom. Now, their commitment to one another doesn't begin at this point. It started before. That commitment, though, has developed and grown through the courtship or the dating process and through the engagement. Until those vows are exchanged, either party is ultimately free to withdraw from the relationship and not commit to a lifetime together. But at the wedding ceremony, that changes. In a wedding ceremony, the bride and groom simply promise to love, honor, and cherish each other for better or worse, for richer or poorer, in sickness and in health, for as long as they both shall live. And both promise to remain faithful to the other until death do us part. For Christians, the marriage covenant is the second most important commitment we will ever make. And the tragedy of a failed marriage is notwithstanding, it is still an important model for us. We are not perfect in our relationships. We are not perfect in our marriages. Marriages fail. And God's redeeming grace has room for restoration and forgiveness. But that doesn't mean that the promises that are made, the vows that are made, are not very important in a wedding, because they point to something even greater, which is our relationship to Christ. The most important commitment we can make is that commitment to Christ. It begins in our baptism, and it is confirmed with the laying on of hands by the bishop. It's in confirmation. Whether the promises were made for us as infants and embraced by us later in life when we were confirmed, or or made by adults like Chase and Stephanie, the vows of baptism are covenantal, just as marriage is covenantal. Peter talked about that pledge as he compared the floodwaters that saved Noah to the act of baptism. 1 Peter 3, 20-21, God patiently waited in the days of Noah as an ark was being built, and the ark of few, that is eight souls, were delivered through water. And this prefigured baptism, which now saves you, not the washing off of physical dirt, but the pledge of a good conscience to God through the resurrection of his son, Jesus Christ. That flood in which the lives of only eight people were saved was symbolic of a much greater salvation. And that is the salvation that is ours in Christ, through which all of these things, including the act of baptism, point. Baptism is a confession of one's faith in Christ. It says to everyone present, I believe in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, the only begotten Son of God, God of God, light of light, very God of very God. I have renounced the world, the flesh, and the devil, the vain pomp and glory of the world, and I have put my trust in he who demands my obedience. It is a reaffirmation of the faith of everyone present. Everyone present is a witness. That baptism is part of the ceremony, not just family and friends. Chase and Stephanie, you today have been adopted by God as his own son and daughter. And you've been released from the law of sin and death by the work of Christ. And you have been washed in the blood of the Lamb, the blood of Christ, and been sanctified by the Holy Spirit. You have committed yourselves to love and serve the Lord who has done these things for you in much the same way that you committed to love and cherish each other. But like every Christian, you will sometimes struggle in your faith and fall short. Nevertheless, Christ will always be there. When we fall, God is always there to lift us up. My prayer for the two of you is that God will always continue to be there for you, for our God is a loving Father who never fails. And his Son, Jesus Christ, loves us enough to die for us, and his Spirit lives within us so that we might know the truth and peace. Do you not know that as many of us that were baptized into Christ were baptized into death? Therefore, we were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we should walk in newness of life. And the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
Then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? How shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? How shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach except they be sent? Remember now the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, our sin is more blessed to give and receive, to bring his thoughts and our own. Thank you. humbly beseech thee most mercifully to accept our alms and oblations, and to receive these our prayers which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and comfort. And grant that all those who confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love. We beseech thee also so to direct and dispose the hearts of all Christian rulers, that they may truly and impartially administer justice to the punishment of wickedness and vice, and to the maintenance of thy true religion and virtue. Your grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and to other ministers, that they may, both by their life and doctrine, set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and newly administer thy holy sacraments. And to all thy people give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. And we most humbly beseech thee, my goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor all those who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear, beseeching thee to grant them continual growth in thy loving service, and to give us grace so to follow their good examples, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant this, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate. Amen. Amen.